Ralf Schütze introduces the new BMW 7 Series, the sixth generation of the luxury sedan. You're always going to expect a lot from a car like this, he says, but an ignition key of this size must mean a load of high-tech highlights. Should be interesting. BMW launched the 7 Series almost four decades ago. 7 years after the introduction of the last generation, the new edition is raring to go. The comprehensive revamping, says BMW, will mean new benchmarks in handling, ride comfort, economy, driver assist, and construction. The lightweight design with carbon fiber and other new materials has meant a significant reduction in weight. Combined with the new suspension system, says the BMW spokesman, it gives the car greater agility and far better handling. The new 7 Series boasts an effective marriage of performance and comfort. Our car man Ralf is very familiar with the 7 Series, and the 6th generation has lost a further 130 kilos depending on the model. And you certainly notice it. It's extremely fleet-footed and feels more like a 3 Series or a 5 Series. You can see the typical BMW design everywhere. The trademark kidney grille has gotten larger. The headlights flatter. The rear's hips and the chrome-tipped exhaust pipes underline the car's sporty image. The interior has a luxurious and spacious feel. Plush materials lend an exclusive and modern touch. The seats promise top-caliber comfort, as you would expect. The enormous legroom in the back translates into a very nice ride. There's a reason for the ignition key being so big, explains Ralf. You can use it to call up the car's remaining driving range and perform other functions, like remote parking. Yes, that means without the driver. Just press the display and the car starts parking itself. A very convenient feature, especially when it comes to tight parking spots. What Ralf really likes is the gesture-operated music system. If he draws a circle with his finger, the volume goes up. Move in the other direction, it goes down. If he points two fingers towards the dash, it will skip to the next track. Awesome. You can call it gadgetry, but just don't be alarmed if you see a 7 Series driver gesticulating wildly. Among the other highlights, the suspension setup. BMW's Wilfried Nixel shows us the driver experience control switch. As with the previous generation, you can choose between a very comfortable suspension and a sportier option. What's new is the adaptive mode. This setting takes into account your driving style and even the kind of road or terrain on your route. Buyers can choose a long or short version, says BMW executive Timo Resch. In the two biggest markets, China and the U.S., long is the only version available. In Europe, the shorter version tends to be more popular. The 7 Series currently comes with a range of three engines, two gasoline units, and a diesel. Entry price for a new 7 Series in Germany is 81,900 euros. So, what does our car reviewer reckon? The sixth generation of the new 7 Series is indeed the lightest, most dynamic, and most efficient sedan in its class. Ralf has a minor gripe with the kidney grille, a signature design feature, but too flashy for his taste. And if you're not into huge high-tech keys, you can always ask for a conventional one. After all, it's about the car, not the high-tech touches. Car tester Matas Kurat asks, ever had the urge to break out of the daily drudge? To pack a few things and go off somewhere away from people, where nature is still untouched? When he was younger, Matas would probably have hopped on a train with his backpack. Today, he picked a somewhat more comfortable alternative, the new VW California. And off we go, along the highways and hairpins of Norway. The first California was designed in 1987 as a budget camper, but the fourth generation is a pretty sophisticated affair. It's based on the T6 Transporter, also launched in 2015. This is a van of many talents, but swimming is not one of them, as Matas discovers, making his way across Norway's many fjords. If the road comes to a watery end, says Matas, it's probably better to take the ferry across, as he has done. It's a bit chilly, so he's going to turn on the heater to make sure it's reasonably warm when he gets back from having a cup of coffee. On the outside, the California barely differs from the regular VW van, just a few details, such as the roof, set this model apart. The ferry crossing takes 2 hours. Then it's time to get in, belt up, and drive off. Don't forget that Matas is on a quest to find untouched nature. When it comes to mastering the narrow, curvy roads up here, the California is a natural. The suspension was already close to passenger car standard in the California's predecessor, explains Matas. The steering's little on the soft side, but overall, it's a good ride. You always have the feeling of being in firm contact with the road. Our van is powered by a 2-liter, 150-kilowatt TDI unit, combined with a 7-speed dual-clutch gearbox. Fuel consumption is rated at 6.4 liters of diesel per 100 kilometers. For Matas, seating comfort is a big factor when choosing a camper van, and it's decent enough in the California, except it's a little drafty around the back of the knees. Entschuldigung. Matas asked some locals which direction Camp California is in. They don't seem to understand it. Of course, the sheep here can only speak Norwegian, right? It's probably better to rely on the onboard sat-nav. There aren't too many side roads to get lost on anyway in these parts. Matas reaches his destination just in time for sunset. A little waterfall, a meadow, a lake, and no civilization as far as the eye can see. Now, let's take a look inside the California. At first glance, the interior hasn't changed much at all. There's still the practical fold-away table built into the sliding door, and two folding chairs stowed away in the tailgate. And the furnishings look pretty much the same. The kitchen unit is more or less identical. Two burners, a tiny sink, plus a small refrigerator. The buttons on the sliding doors are a little higher up so that you can still reach them when the bed is down. And instead of cotton fabric, the roof bellows are made of polyester. The dashboard is new. The heater controls are the same as the outgoing model. Time to close the curtains and call it a night. The morning after, Matas reckons those little changes do make sleeping and living here in general more comfortable. Yes, the polyester roof is not soundproof, but that's normal for a camper van. He's now off back to civilization, but could well imagine buying himself a recreation vehicle like this baby.
Also, ich mache mich jetzt wieder auf den Rückweg in die Zivilisation, könnte mir aber durchaus vorstellen, so ein Auto vielleicht mal zu kaufen.
The last S-Class convertible came out in 1971, but at the upcoming International Frankfurt Motor Show, Mercedes will be unveiling the new edition, an open-top affair. The S63 AMG with all-wheel drive makes the dash to 100 kilometers per hour in 3.9 seconds. The V8 bi-turbo engine with 430 kilowatts of output has a hefty fuel economy of 10.4 liters per 100 kilometers and a CO2 emissions rating of 244 grams. Audi will likewise be in Frankfurt with a new edition of the A4 Avant. The horizontal contouring at the front and rear give the station wagon a wider look than its predecessor. The body, as with the Q7, is part aluminum. That saves weight and boosts fuel economy. The cargo area has 505 liters of space. The new model offers a choice of 7 engines. Prices for the 1.4 TFSI edition start at 32,500 euros in Germany. The legendary Nürburgring recently hosted the World Endurance Championships for the very first time. The WEC is the second most popular racing series after Formula One. Teams compete in 8 races on 4 continents for the title. Porsche joined just last year. We thought about which event was the right one for the company and soon came across the sports prototypes. Porsche used to take part in those races. It's a lot of fun for the spectators and the team because of the similarity to road-going editions. For now, Porsche has decided to take part through to 2018, and everyone is really excited about it. The World Endurance Championship divides cars into 4 categories. Le Mans Prototype 1 is the top class. Innovation is the name of the game. Energy recovery systems built into each car maximize engine efficiency. Porsche entered 2 cars in the race, numbers 17 and 18. In car 17, Timo Bernhardt, Brendan Hartley, and former Formula One driver Mark Webber.
I think the first few races and also last year WEC's getting very interesting. The cars are sensational to watch on track. They're sexy, they're fast. So I think the people know that, you know, for €35 they have a ticket for all weekend and they have this access. It's a very hard opportunity not to come and see the cars and watch the racing.
Porsche dominated at the qualifiers at the Nürburgring. After winning in Le Mans in June, the car maker decided to revamp the bodies of its 919 hybrids for the 5 remaining races. The new design has helped push performance even further. Porsche beat its nearest competitor, Audi, with more than a second to spare. Toyota came trailing a full 2 seconds behind. Porsche's research and development director was happy with the result. I think we showed a great performance. We are confident going forward. The long runs yesterday and today were good. I think we have set ourselves up well for tomorrow, where we can start from the front. I also think tomorrow will get a bit tighter, but we will do everything we can to stay in the lead. Before the final race, drivers take a timeout for the fans, lined up to meet their heroes in person, and maybe even have a chat or snap a selfie with a star. The stands fill up in anticipation for the competition. The six-hour Enduro-thon starts out with Porsche at the front. Car 18 enjoys a comfortable lead ahead of the pack. But a problem with the gas tank jeopardizes its chances of a win. A broken sensor is relaying incorrect information, and the hybrid 919 starts using too much gas. The WEC has strict rules on fuel consumption. The first warning comes with a 5-second penalty. Repeat offenders have to wait 30 seconds in the pits. The third penalty is a crushing 60-second penalty. Precious time in a race where every second counts. Mechanics aren't allowed to work on the car when it is parked in the sin bin. A serious setback and a hard lesson for the R&D chief. The boost pressure sensor moved, and then we had a problem with establishing the right amount of pressure, which resulted in excess boost. The car used too much fuel twice. We still have to talk with the race organizers. The third stop and go penalty wasn't fair, but it all still worked out for us by the end. After 6 hours of concentrated driving, number 17 crosses the line first. Porsche wins the first World Endurance Championship race hosted by the Nürburgring. And not far behind, with an impressive piece of catching up, number 18 takes second spot. Applause all around at Porsche. 919 driver Mark Webber says it was a hard win.
Yeah, need to be fully concentrated. I think that the start of the race for us was a bit tricky with some damage on the car. And then we hung in there. Then obviously 18 had some problems with some fuel flow problems. And so, yeah, and then you never have Audi out of the game, you know, so you have to stay concentrated. But in the end, I think it was a good result. It was a great 1-2, obviously. And I mean, of course, it's a good result. But finally for us on 17, we had a little bit of, I think we deserved the victory. We've had a few races where we've been leading and not having the result with the reliability. Now we had a great race.
It was one of automotive history's odd men out. Exploring the Italian Alps in an eccentric vintage car is a rare experience. The Cord 812 looks a bit like the caffeine fit of a mad cap designer. Or maybe like a masterpiece by a brilliant automobile tycoon. As cartista Christoph Bauer tells us, hardly anyone knows Arret Loben Cord's name today, but he was a shining example of the American dream. He started small as a gas station attendant and car salesman and worked his way up to become owner of the Auburn and Duesenberg car makers, two of the most renowned car companies of the time. In 1929, he launched a third company named after himself, Cord Automobiles. As a young but experienced entrepreneur, Arret Loben Cord should have put the wishes and needs of his customers first, but he didn't. He used the Cord automobile to experiment, to build a car that would be new and different. From the beginning, Cord stood out for its striking design and innovative technologies. In 1929, front-wheel drive made its American debut in the first Cord model, the L29. The 812 SC also put the power on the front axle, practically unheard of at the time. But the powerful turbocharged V8 engine quickly pushed the narrow tires to the limits of their traction. The Cord had trouble handling tight curves. Even so, it was one of the fastest cars of its day. With the help of its streamlined body, the Cord 812 SC achieved a top speed of 160 kilometers per hour. The original advertising brochure boasted that the reduction of drag was a crucial factor, a new concept at the time, like most of the Cord's technical components. Christoph describes the Cord as a dream for beginning drivers. If they happened to stall the Cord's engine, the driver just had to step on the clutch, and it automatically started again. And it shifted with a flick of a finger. The pneumatic pre-selector transmission tiptoed through the three gears, plus overdrive semi-automatically. And at a time when few cars even had windshield wipers, the Cord had variable speed wipers. It was the first car with a radio as standard equipment and hidden headlights. In the 1930s, that was as sophisticated as technology got. What a mean nose, says Christoph. That's the impression this Cord must have made at the time, with its massive wraparound chrome grille, the pop-up headlights, and above all, these chromed external pipes. The car must have seemed like some bizarre insect from a faraway galaxy. Gordon Burick, a world-famous industrial designer at the time, put little value on understatement, but a lot of elegance and aerodynamics. This was one of the first cars with door hinges mounted inside. Till then, they'd always been sticking out, looking a bit clunky. The design of the Cord was a perfect dream, but only its design. In the 1930s, the Cord 812 and its optically identical predecessor, the 810, revolutionized American automotive design with its harmonious and sweeping lines. The three hearts in the logo were said to stand for E.L. Cord's love for his cars. That's easy to believe, given the breathtaking detail of this work of art on wheels. The fine aluminum dashboard with easily readable instruments, the filigree shifting gate, the many sculpted levers and dignified club atmosphere show Cord's automotive vision extends into the interior as well. The Cord's pop-up headlights, the first in any production car anywhere, did not become a common sight till 30 years later. The hood is what gave the Cord the nickname Coffin Nose. It enclosed a V8 engine made by Lycoming, one of the leading American aircraft engine builders. Normally, it put out some 125 horsepower, but this SC version, with a Schwitzer-Cummings centrifugal supercharger, achieved 170 horsepower and a top speed of 160 kilometers per hour, faster than almost any other production car at the time. In combination with the supercharger's hum, the V8 and its 4.7-liter capacity produced an unparalleled sound. On the outside, the Cord is an eye-catcher and a half. But under the hood, it was fraught with problems. At its debut at the 1935 New York Auto Show, the Cord 812 caused a sensation. Everybody rushed to see the masterpiece of design, and hundreds of pre-orders came pouring in. But the Cord was simply not ready for production, not by a long shot. As so often happens when things are rushed, things go wrong. The first models were delivered in 1936, but the many technical bugs soon made the dream car a complete nightmare. The Cord's engine was prone to overheating, the transmission to jumping out of gear, and the cooling system to leaking. And its nearly 1.7 tons proved far less manageable than the dynamic design made it appear. In just 8 years, Cord had gone bust. Christoph concludes that the Cord may have been one of America's most innovative makes, but it was also certainly one of its most short-lived. Even so, it was a good 30 years ahead of its time in design, aerodynamics, and technology. But as so often with innovators, their true value is often only recognized when it's too late. Today, it's obvious the Cord 812 was a milestone in automotive history. Only about 3,000 Cord 812s were ever built, 134 of them as the coveted supercharged SC version. the Cord took its sisters, Auburn and Duesenberg, down with it. What's left is the beauty, the elegance, and the dream.